Greetings. Welcome back, everybody. Today is the 4th of December, 2021. I'm gathered here with Michael. We have the 76th session in Science is the New Religion with Michael in Germany. Welcome, Michael.
Yeah, welcome, Brett. Hello, dear listeners. I'm home alone at the moment. It's already dark outside. It's 5:40 p.m. and it's raining and it's a mess outside. Yeah, what do we expect from the world outside when they even can mess up with the weather, which we have talked about in the last session? So I'm now coming up with a new block of sessions. I don't know if we need three or four of them when we go down to the path of the modern science, so to speak. We have left Einstein and Tesla, and we are now coming to the modern science. As I don't know if you have followed the satanic media agenda when we covered the subject of Christopher Lee. And I went into Christopher Lee with all these secret societies, him being more or less in the Secret Service, being a spy and all the things around it. And now we're coming from a different angle, but I don't know from this session on or maybe from the next session on. So that everything is out there is a deception, which you cannot prove. So either you got only two possibilities, either you believe it or you know it. So if you were not there, if you were not present at the event, when an event happened, you cannot know anything. You have to believe the news, the media, the book, the source, the witness, whomsoever, you have to believe. So the question arises, first of all, for everything in life, do you know it? Or only it or in it? If you were not present at the site of an accident, at the site of something happening in life, at the site of the war, everybody can tell you everything or anything. Mm-hmm. Everybody can tell you lies. Everybody can tell you false stories. Everybody can tell you incomplete stories. So from now on, we have to be very careful what we have been presented all our life.
Michael, I can smell bearing false witness.
Yeah, that's the modern media or mass media. You see, the mass media for the masses of people on the Broadway is there to deceive the people. Mm. If the majority of people is the Antichrist people, then you got the Antichrist television set, the mass media, the Antichrist media. So they lie in your face because they cover the subject for the people who are already in the spirit of Satan, in the spirit of the father of lies. So when they have been presented with lies, they see that as the truth. It's John 8:44, actually. It's the father of lies. It's Satan. So when you have a satanic, if you have the satanic agenda running, then you have been presented by the media the things they want to show you so that you believe in the things you have been shown. Therefore, I hope my English is sufficient to present to you another thing which came into my mind a few years ago, which is very, very recent. And it's just like a connecting rod from the ancient times and from the former episodes we did do to the modern science. And the approaching verse for Brett, please to read, is John chapter 8, verse 44.
Which reads, "Ye are of your father the devil, and the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it."
Mm-hmm. So he spoke these verses to the Jews who did not believe in him. And we know from another chapter in John that everybody who does not confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God is in the spirit of Antichrist. So he talked to and spoke to the people in the spirit of Antichrist. He was not talking, that is a much, much common used error, in my humble opinion. He did not talk to the general Jews or to the Jews in general, to the common Jews. He did speak to the people who did not believe that he was something special. He did talk to the Jews who were just trying to approach him, accused him, etc., and who could not recognize him as the Christ, meaning of people in the Antichrist. And I think it was in 1 John, please correct me if I'm wrong, Brad, who spoke that Jesus said that everybody who is not confessing that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from the spirit of Antichrist.
I think that's correct.
But where it is?
Well, all you have to do is search Antichrist.
I know. Oh, it's 2 John. Okay, so I knew it was in the...
First or second, John. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, you see that is here, 1 John 2, and then verse 7.
Yep, 2 John chapter 1, verse 7, which reads, "For many deceivers are entered into the world who confess not." Let me repeat that. "For many deceivers are entered into the world who confess not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist." Double whammy, Michael.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So every authority or every TV station which is presenting something to you which would go against the Bible, especially the New Testament, is of Antichrist. So now I present you with something that I don't think that you would ever come up with it. It's session 76. Okay, science is the new religion. So question yourself, in every event that you see from now on, especially when we come to the modern age with the modern media, with smartphones, television, broadcasting services, computer games, simulations, etc., question please everything. Everything. You cannot trust your own eyes because the media is there to deceive you. We know that media comes from Media Persia or Medo Persia, there where the Magi were then handing over these subjects, and the Magi were the priests. They were Antichrist priests. Except the three wise men who came to the baby Jesus, or maybe four of them, or maybe 20 of them, or maybe two of them. We do not know the number, but except the small amount of the wise men coming from the East. And they were wise because they bowed down to the baby Jesus. They bowed down to God, God in the flesh. So they were not in the spirit of Antichrist. They were in the spirit of Christ because they wanted to visit him. They want to honor him. That's the big thing. So everything which is about science, which is excluding God, like this Atomium model, yeah, it's Atomium in Brussels, the capital city in Belgium. Yeah, atom is more or less the modern phrase of Adam. Yeah, could be, must not necessarily mean, but you see that phonetically it sounds almost similar. So do you know something or don't you only believe in it? And it's not the main thing in what now is coming up. Sorry for me stuttering a little bit, but we have to think about as science being presented to us as a kind of fiction. Yeah, so a kind of a story. So what does fiction actually mean? Yeah. So, fiction.
It has to do with illusion, doesn't it?
Invention, fabrication. A fashioning, a feigning, noun of an article, to shape, form, device, original, to tread, to form out of clay. So, to create something for your mind. It's fiction. It's not real. Huh? It's not real. It's an invention. Meaning is... something with the imagination. So you think of something which is not there in the first place. Okay, so now I draw the curtain wide open. It's not this. It's session 76. Yeah, welcome to the Red Bull. And you might ask what is now coming up. It's about Matador, it's about bullfights or something like that. No, it's not. It's actually about the Red Bull Stratos. Never heard of it? Ah, you will soon discover what's it all about. It's about a refreshment. drink. Ne? Ah, schade. Let me check. I think 130 fits the best. Yes. It's about a refreshment ding from Red Bull, from Austria. Don't know this? Maybe you don't know that, I don't know, but yeah, there are some other similar refreshment drinks with caffeine and taurine and all the stuff to keep you awake in it. For example, I know of a very famous lemonade or something like this in the United States called Rockstar. Huh? Yeah, so that is a similar thing. And this is just the beginning of a very interesting item. We are talking about things that have been presented to us and we have to see it in a different way. On the left side, you see that bottle here of an energy drink. And on the right side, you see Mr. Felix Baumgartner. Never heard of him? Really? Felix Baumgartner? Oh, he once held a world record. Let's go into Felix Baumgartner. Felix Baumgartner is an Austrian skydiver, daredevil, and base jumper. He is best known for jumping to Earth from a helium balloon from the stratosphere on the 14th of October 2012 and landing in New Mexico, United States as part of the Red Bull Stratos project. Doing so, he set world records for skydiving, an estimated 39 kilometers, 24 miles, reaching an estimated top speed of 843 miles an hour or Mach 1.25. He became the first person to break the sound barrier relative to the surface without vehicular power on his descent. He broke skydiving records for exit altitude, etc., etc., etc. Baumgartner is also renowned for the particular dangerous nature of the stunts he has performed during his career. He spent time in the Austrian military, where he practiced parachute jumping, including training to land on small target zones. So, first of all, let me ask you, Brett, you are aware of Felix Baumgartner?
Yeah, I did watch that event some years ago, where supposedly they were up there with the camera, some cameras.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
It was very strange. I definitely kind of, you know, made my head spin for a little bit. Well, wait, how can they do this? But anyway, okay, but yeah, Michael.
Yeah, you will experience my train of thoughts very soon. This is a tribute to Mr. Felix Baumgartner in the Street of the Victors in Vienna, in Austria. Yeah, and Maria, as the helper, as the mother of Jesus, the Street of Maria. Yeah, so that's the Red Bull Stratos. Yeah, that is the event which took place sponsored by that energy drink. Yeah, and high altitude skydiving project involving Austrian skydiver Felix Baumgartner. So what does that to do with odor sessions?
And what location, Michael? Roswell, what? New Mexico?
Yeah, all become up now.
This
all
isn't a joke up. Now, is it?
No, absolutely not. Remember that I just wrote to you that he's coming from the Austrian military?
Okay, very interesting, Michael. Mm-hmm. Keep going.
So this is Baumgartner, Mr. Baumgartner, and he's a very straightforward guy. And now this is just the German part of the script. And because intentionally I thought I'd do it as in German, but I don't have the time for that. Felix, where are you?
It's one of the few first tabs, isn't it? No. Oh, you closed it.
I closed it, yes. Got so many things open. I hope that the computer will sustain.
Sure.
So, it is not mentioned here on the English Wikipedia. So, then once again, let's go to the German Wikipedia of Felix Baumgartner. You will soon see that it's nothing new under the sun. Felix Baumgartner. So let's look it up. Red Bull Stratos. Okay, that's it. Oh, okay, that is maybe we will face it also in English. Okay. Yep. Yeah. Oh, no, don't. This is really amazing that you don't find it in
really?
That you don't find it in the English Wikipedia. This is so hilarious. So
there's gotta be reasons for that. I think, yeah, go ahead.
So So the project Red Stratos was a base jump from the stratosphere from about 40 kilometers of high on the 14th October, etc., etc., etc. The project was namely sponsored by the Austrian drink manufacturer Red Bull and was being technical assisted by the NASA, National Aeronautic and Space Agency, I think it is, and the United Air Force. So this is a military project. Featuring somebody who came from the Austrian military as a parachute jumper or space jumper, etc., etc. So the military is included. Remember that Brad said, oh, yeah, this Area 51, huh? Roswell? Mm-hmm. Yeah, Roswell, exactly. So let's face it, please, that we have to believe that there was somebody falling down from 24 miles down below. And we all seen these pictures and these movies. And I don't have to doubt the fact that he did it. I appreciate the fact that he survived. Yeah, but it's not my intention now to doubt the fact that he did it. I got another approach about that, because I came to the conclusion there's something to it. Let's face it. This was the capsule.
Yeah, that looks right.
Yeah. And it was starting especially in Roswell, New Mexico, which exactly, of course, is the Area 51, which means that this was a military project featuring a military guy. And military support, of course, because you have to have the infrastructure with all the communication to 24 miles. You cannot do it on a private level, okay? So I looked upon the indications here, what really happened on that occasion. And he says that here, this is the European time code in 9:31. So that's 9:31 a.m., for example. The capsule was being released. Yeah, usually the start should approach at 6 o'clock in the morning, 6 a.m. in the morning, or 2 p.m. Middle European summertime, but had to postpone for large winds several times. And then at 9:31, the capsule was on its own. So it was ascending, okay? Okay, ascending. So the height of 120,000 feet was being approached at 12:07. So at 12:07, or a few minutes ago, at 12:07, he was jumping from that kind of 127,452 feet. Okay, so you got now the time when he was ascending. He ascended more than 2.5 hours. Okay, he said, I know the whole world is watching now. I wish you could see what I can see. Sometimes you have to be really high to understand how small you are. I'm going home now. Yeah, that's what he said. That was his famous last words. And he was losing control about his position. And he had a big hard time to stay conscious, if I remember correctly. Okay, so that he was doing at a tremendous speed of more than 1 Mach. Yeah, okay, that's free fall, but nevertheless. So it's been depicted here that he was landing at 12:16. Yeah, so 12:16 p.m. Severe and not hurt around 70 kilometers, that's about 45 miles east of the location where he started. And then helicopter, yeah. Helicopter. Okay. Ah. Yeah. A helicopter was receiving him and was being transporting him to Walker Air Force Base. Once again, Air Force Base. Okay, so that's that. So these are the records here, which he has broken. Yeah. So that's that. The Stratos project is one of the most successful owned media projects. The costs were about 25 million euros. But they had an effect of public effect or public relations about of 1 billion euros. Yeah? Okay, so they made big money with that. So that is the official story. Now, my story comes. This is Mr. Felix Baumgartner. This is the picture you see on Wikipedia, both in German and English. This is a picture you see on Pinterest. And this is a picture you see on a German magazine. Huh? This is photoshopped. You see, from the original pictures transmitted from
sure,
yeah,
Michael.
it's this, but if you go to a German geo, which means geology, and you see that is highly modified because the cameras were not that big. Yeah, and it's just a modified picture here. So you cannot take everything for granted. And especially if it does not happen in Roswell, Mexico. Why is that? Because you see that it's in the middle of the desert. And yes, you cannot hurt that many people out there, and you can have their your privacy. So that is Geo, Mr. Felix Baumgartner, Mission Stratos. I don't know if that picture is up now. Oh, it does not look very promising. Consent, you have to consent everything. So I don't doubt that he has jumped. I don't doubt that he has jumped very high. I don't doubt the figures. But you have to take it from another approach, which you will now find out. These are the numbers they point to you. So they say he was falling 4 minutes and 19 seconds, okay? So these are all the facts of the jump. So this is a picture of him approaching out of the capsule. Felix Baumgartner space jump. We can look it on YouTube if my computer allows me to. And you now will, in 2 minutes, I think you will find out why I have looked upon it from a different angle. For example, this, you see with that motion here. Okay, so we go into this video here. Are you 6 years old? Oh. you see, that's what's all about. So imagine this picture is correct. And now you are absolutely wrong if you think it has something to do about the shape of the Earth. This is absolutely not my point, as I was pointing out sessions before. But what does that has to do with the sessions we already did? Well, you see, you got the time codes here. You know that this action here took place 2 hours and 34 minutes and 9 seconds, 10, 11, etc. You see the height here. Therefore, you can, of course, calculate the speed, the average speed at least. When from the time he took off and until he landed. That's basic mathematician. That's absolutely no big deal. Do you read me, Felix, on communications? Oxygen supply. So if this is correct, then science has another problem. At least if you have followed our sessions about session 60 to 70. Okay? Always nice to look at from that perspective if somebody is so brave to jump back to. Okay, so that is the real event. If that event took place, nobody can tell because nobody has the ability to go that high up. Nobody has the ability to, without any technical computer monitor, to locate him. Nobody has the ability to check the entire event. But we assume that this event is correct. He was traveling at that moment 2 hours and 38 seconds before he reached 40,000 meters, or 39,000 meters equals 128,000 feet. Okay? So then he had to jump. And we know that the jump took place 4 minutes at 19 seconds. So you add to that point where he started to jump, 4 minutes and a few seconds. So it will turn out that it is about 2 hours and 42 minutes. Now we calculate in minutes. That is 120 and 42, 162 minutes, correct? Now we got the Earth, and the Earth as a globe has been stated that it has 12,742 kilometers, not miles, kilometers. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So then we go. I have to look where I am. Yeah. So the Earth rotates once every 23 hours, 56 minutes, and 4 seconds. The circumference is roughly 40,075 kilometers. Thus, the surface of the Earth at the equator moves at a speed of 460 meters per second, or roughly 1,000 miles per hour. Now you know why I came up with that base jump, I think. Because 12,742 diameter multiplied with pi is 40,000 something circumference, 40,000 kilometers. And we know that the Earth is about to spin once a day. So you divide the 40,000 kilometers into 24 hours, you come up with a speed in kilometers of 1,666 or 1,667, which equals in miles, yeah, about divided to 1.6, about 1,000 miles per hour. This is therefore roughly 1,000 miles per hour. So that means if Felix did leave the Earth 2 hours and 42 minutes from liftoff until he went down to Earth, that's about 2 hours, 42 minutes, yeah, means 2.7 hours, means 4,500 kilometers that the Earth has moved in that period. Then he was away from the Earth. 4,500 kilometers the Earth was supposedly spinning. We are talking about a so-called or presumed heliocentric system. You know, Galileo, Kepler, and all the people have taught us that this is a heliocentric Earth. No, the Earth is spinning and the Sun is fixed. So if the Earth is spinning, then the Earth spun during the time when Felix was way up and fixed, and then descending, ascending, descending. The Earth had reached a direction or a turn of about 4,500 kilometers. Yeah, 4,500 kilometers divided to 1.6, which is in miles per hour, would be about 2,900 miles. Okay, I can calculate a little bit more exactly. 2,812, I think that's sufficient. Okay, so 2,800 miles. Mm-hmm. Red Bull Stratos, inside view, Felix Baumgartner. I read it for you. The morning of March 15, 2012, Felix Baumgartner landed with his parachute in a New Mexico desert nearly 30 miles away from Roswell, wearing a spacesuit. 30 miles away, a wonder of physics and precision. So it's quite simple. You leave the Earth and you stay a few minutes and look upon the Earth and you say, oh, it's very beautiful. I'm going home now. And then you jump and then you reach Mach 1 velocity and you hammer down the Earth. Then your parachute is going up, luckily. And then you are receiving on the Earth and happy and you got a world record and everybody's fine. Huh? And during that time, these 2 hours and 42 minutes and few seconds, etc., the Earth has moved supposedly 2,800 miles, but you succeeded to just land 30 miles away from Roswell. That's quite clear, Brett, or?
Well, you know, Michael, first of all, you already pointed out it's a heliocentric, systematic kind of thinking that says the Earth is in rotation, right?
Mm-hmm.
But we know the Earth is stationary since the Bible states the Earth is stationary. Therefore, the wind, when it's properly, you know, they had to wait for the wind. I'm assuming this is a balloon that went up, correct? So it took 2 hours and 40 minutes to get up there. That's 24 miles, you said? 24 miles high. That's a long.
Yeah. 24 miles high. Yes, correct.
They were going at a pretty good clip then to get up there in 2 hours and 40 minutes, I guess, considering it's a balloon. But anyway, no, I don't see any problem. Other than, you know, it's just really strange to look at that video. And it's just really a strange thing. It's not natural at all. It doesn't seem natural to me because, you know.
It serves only the purpose of Red Bull. Yeah. And the bull is also a symbol for the Greek god of Zeus. But it serves only that manufacturer and serves only the person of Felix Baumgartner. It doesn't help mankind, of course. It's just the egoistic thing that we do it because we can. Yeah, we can. Mm-hmm. And sure. Yeah, but the thing is that when he was jumping then to his world record at that time, 2012 it was, yeah, he was jumping and you can tell that the earth is fixed.
Yeah,
you see that the earth from that perspective on that balloon, which is not fixed everywhere. Yeah, the earth seems to be fixed. The Earth doesn't seem to rotate with 1,000 miles per hour, and even so, if it did, then even in the few minutes he was then stationary.
But Michael, now we get to apply what we've learned already in our sessions to what's really happening here, as we can observe from the cameras, is that, you know, this theory of relativity brought forth by a Jesuit, right? Was promoted by Albert Einstein in order to get everyone thinking about the heliocentric relative point of view of the sun. They want everyone to be sun-centric, correct? So they had to promote a Jesuit theory of relativity so that everyone would be thinking about, you know, it's all relative. Meaning, if I choose to worship Lucifer, then I have my freedom of religion, don't I?
Yeah, but the thing is not only about this guardian angel, which is here mentioned, but the thing is that it does not make sense if you look at it from a heliocentric system. And they, of course, have to claim, oh, and this is all BS what I'm talking about, because they have been taught that the atmosphere is spinning too.
Yeah.
Then how come that the balloon went straight up?
Well, because the earth, listen, the air, as long as the air stream or the jet stream isn't moving too quickly, is not going to move the balloon too far away from target then. So they had to wait for the wind at the right altitude, would be my assumption, to slow down enough for them to stay on target. That would be my assumption. So when they raise the balloon up, then it won't get carried away with the jet stream and go way off target, right? So I don't see a problem.
In the Antichrist system, you've been taught that the atmosphere is spinning too, but you don't occur any hurricanes here constantly. So you have also calm moments. So how come when they explain that the earth is rotating and the atmosphere is rotating, that you can go up straight, when they tell you that it is like a merry-go-round here on the earth? And I have also one guy.
Right, because their theory is full of holes and they don't tell you that's, you know, you have the distance at the equator, and that's different when you move across, you know, different.
Yeah, I know. I would have now to calculate with the cosinus and also what to get the.
Ridiculous how much people, you know, yeah, explain this stuff. But it's technical. I mean, it's not.
That's a technical session here. If you would have to, it's like the four-chord pendulum. Yeah, you would have to go right. to the latitude. You have to calculate now the latitude of Roswell, New Mexico, etc. So it is not 2,800 miles. Maybe it's 2,200 miles. So but it does not matter. You see that the distance that he reached his target within 1%, yeah, or 30 miles away from Roswell. Yeah, he landed almost there where he started. Yeah, if you come down from about 24 miles, then 30 miles away from Roswell, that is much spot on. Yeah, so he did not land 2,000 miles apart or 1,000 miles or 500 miles. No, he landed exactly there where he was supposed to be. And then you look at the video, footage where he was trembling. And he was spinning on his own axis. He could not have any control. Yeah, and he's in free fall. It's not a computer model here, supposedly. It is the real guy. You see that even in that model, you see that he's not having the control of it. But he, despite of that, he just was just landing in the area which was of use for him and which was no danger of him. Can you imagine he was landing in an area of New York? On top of the Empire State Building or what? Yeah, you see that you have to question that.
Or worse, in the ocean,
Yeah, and now that people are telling you, they are really telling you that the atmosphere is spinning too. This is the official explanation of that video for people who are always raised the questions that cannot be because the Earth is rotating with more than 1,000 kilometers or 1,000 miles per hour. He was a few hours in the air, so he would have landed much away. And people say now, oh no, this is wrong science because everybody who is on the Earth is also rotating with the atmosphere. And so if you don't want to rotate with the atmosphere, you would have to achieve with a plane at least with 1,000 kilometers against west. And I said, no, that is not an argument because you got a plane on the globe system from one direction to another. That would mean that if the Earth is spinning, then the plane would take much more time to go in one direction than the other, because in the other direction, he would not have to move at all because he's already moving with 1,000 miles per hour. Huh? How can that be? No, they have to come up with the explanation that the atmosphere is moving too, and so that the plane has a propulsion of his own, and so they can reach, therefore, every part of the so-called Earth. Yeah, got a very big problem with that because of Felix Baumgartner. Because you see that Felix Baumgartner achieved a task that he landed near exactly there where he was supposed to be. And please remember, this is Area 51. This is Roswell. Mm-hmm. So they come up with futile explanations, which is all in their Jesuitical science, of course. This is because it's a theory. It's a theory, and I have made a big argument, and I have lost a so-called friend about that item here 1 year ago, and I told him all his explanations are actually BS, because he told me, yeah, of course, it's 30 miles away, because you have to calculate not only the movement of the wind, but also the inertia and the Coriolis effect that the balloon then is spinning together with the atmosphere. But then the problem occurs that the atmosphere in 24 miles high is also much more thinner than on ground level. You see, you cannot go with the heliocentric system. Yeah, they have to come up, even with Quora, they have to come up with studied people who then tells you that you have to escape Earth's gravity as well. You see, you are totally in the Jesuitical system. It only creates that people think that you are the lunatic because they have studied physics at the University of Sao Paulo. Yeah, of course, they have studied Jesuitical physics. Yeah, and we are being accused of being ignorant of physics, but actually it is them who are being ignorant of their common sense. Because as we have pointed out in the Foucault pendulum, you cannot measure something because you have no absolute point of rest. Huh. So when the balloon is in 24 miles high, the atmosphere is much more thinner. That is the reason why Mr. Baumgartner was equipped with a helmet and oxygen.
Right, correct.
Why do they talk about oxygen here? Oxygen supply, huh? Yeah, because the density of the air is much more thinner and much more different than on zero ground or ground zero or what else you might. Or ground zero is a term which is erased today. Ground zero usually depicts the point of a nuclear impact. Not many people know that fact. Yeah, so that is what they come up. They blame you on being ignorant of physics when they are ignorant and only been taught Jesuitical science. That's it. Yeah, they claim these studied people at this moment, Mr. Louis de Assès, if it is his real name, I don't know, this is the internet. Now take the atmosphere, for example, the atmosphere is spinning with the Earth or else we would have constant hurricanes. Yeah, then why do we have hurricanes at all? And why is it possible that people have the clue that they absolutely know that the atmosphere is spinning when there is no clue that we are living in a heliocentric system? But they assume that all the theories that who line up, of course, heliocentric system, atmosphere spinning, gravity, theory of relativity, etc., 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 just take it for granted. But it's just a theory upon a theory upon a theory. And they don't get it, these so-called intelligent people, and I don't take the blame on him, they don't get it that they are being fooled by biology teachers thinking of themselves being created by accident from a Big Bang, and they also take it for granted that they are being descendants of apes. How intelligent is that? Yeah, so they come up with so many examples of a car moving at a speed, etc., that has nothing to do. This is the same example or more or less than Einstein came up with the theory of relativity. Yeah. So that is the big problem. And that's what I tried to point out, that if you want to have a successor on the study of the heliocentric system, meaning the so-called pendulum hoax and Galileo's claims and Kepler's futile things and all the Jesuitical science, then you just look with your own eyes to Felix Baumgartner, and what you really see is fixed Earth. And what you really see is somebody who is able to reach the altitude and then to jump down to Earth and to land near the point where he started. That's about it. And the atmosphere here is so different that people have to take control of his oxygen supply. Mm-hmm. So blinding you with science means to distract somebody with the use of big words of its complex explanations. Oh, you have forgotten the wind direction. You have forgotten the altitude. You have forgotten the density. You have forgotten the Coriolis effect. You have forgotten the inertia. You have forgotten this. You have forgotten that. And it takes nothing away from the point that the Earth and the atmosphere is not moving. Because this is common sense. This is not something you have to study. If you study this, you cannot prove it. You cannot prove that the atmosphere is spinning. So it is just a belief system, and that's it. And this is just Felix Baumgartner as one of my prime examples that you use common sense against Jesuitical science. And if you think that is a coincidence that it started on Area 51, well, then we have to go to the next big step, to page number 56. This is a company called NASA. NASA. Somebody heard NASA. NASA. Okay, so NASA, that's an abbreviation. We look it up in English, and in English it tells us that the explanation of that is National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Then I go into English for your comfort.
Thank you, Michael.
Yeah. So what does the NASA has to do with Area 51 and all the stuff? First of all, do you see anything conspicuous here? Hmm? No, you don't? Well, if you look upon the official side, look at this. Oh, it's independent? No, it's not independent. It is dependent. Because that is a website which is connected to the government.
Of course.
It is not NASA.com or NASA.us or what else? It's NASA.gov.
It's not Starlink.
No, that's a real problem. Yeah. And then if you have the background and all the sessions we've done before, you go to that website and you got it right straight in your face. What's the first thing which comes up on that website? Be not distracted from that woman that succeeded in the Garden of Eden to distract us. But please, not here at the NASA, not that in that session here. And not about the sun here, sun is rising and the sun god. No, it's the missions.
Oh, yeah, missions.
Even in the English Wikipedia article, I was just out of luck or out of just fun, I typed in mission. Yeah, it's 98 times on that home, on that main page of the Wikipedia, man. It tells you mission.
Man.
Yeah, bam, 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 bam. We know that mission is a word of Jesuits.
Yes.
It bam, is. Bam, 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 bam. And now you know.
So already, what's the mission? What's the mission?
That's their mission. Yeah, we know already.
That Jesuits were created for the destruction of Protestantism, the Counter-Reformation.
It's an agency. It's an agency. It's original, sending abroad as an ancient original of Jesuits. What does NASA's explanation is? Huh? It's an administration. And it has to do with the government. And there are missions to accomplish. 98 times missions. 98 time missions in an article of, I don't know, 20 pages or so. Yeah, mission, 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 mission. Actually, you cannot come across mission in every three or four sentences. You have to that mission. Mission, mission, mission. Yeah. So you know already that it is a Jesuitical or a religious approach. Yeah, so case closed at this moment. But I think that you all are waiting and eager to look deeply into the history of space travel and space stations. Yeah, ah, because they tell you that it's an independent agency. An agency? Well, let's get back. Ascending abroad as an agent. Oh. Then
not far from the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, Michael.
No,
I don't really know. Doesn't.
It is in a script. It's an independent agency. And if you go back to that point of a mission, it has something to do with an agent. And it is a government supported site or a government located and hosted site. Yeah. So the U.S. federal government is responsible for the civilian. Civilian means an inhabitant, a civilian of Rome. That civilian actually means in my regard. Space program, so you've been programmed, as well as aeronautics and space research. But it's not independent because you see that it's NASA.gov. So you're... Yeah, if you think that your government is independent, then you're free to go. Yeah, I don't think it was. Yeah, but the NASA succeeded the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, which was being founded in 1915 already. Yeah, that's why they have another logo. They have the logo of the Brothers Wright with their first constructed plane, for example. Yeah, so that is the NASA. And before we go into the NASA, of course, we have to think about something else. Something else means we have to think about, before we go into the next session very deep into the roots of the NASA, and I think you will be afraid sometimes what the actual roots of your space agency is. we go into the history where it all happens. For example,
Michael, I just got this idea. I hope you don't mind. I've got to interrupt you for a moment. Something just came to my mind this week, and I was just right now thinking, well, you know, we have an idea now of what NASA represents, but what I want to ask you, Michael, has to do with long before NASA. There is this company in the United States called Ford Motor Company. Mm-hmm. Now, I know Ford was involved in the war machine in Germany. Mm-hmm. And it would be interesting to get your perspective on that sometime. And I just thought I'd inject this in here because would this have something to do with NASA in the long run?
In the long run, they're all connected. As far as I know, that Mr. Ford was a member of a secret society. It was Henry Ford.
For sure.
And Henry Ford was also making big business with the German dictator Adolf Hitler. So they have manufactured or founded a German branch of Ford in Cologne. So it's nearby me. Yeah. So they made in Cologne, they made then also war vehicles. So lorries. Well, what's that? Henry Ford, not Eau de Cologne, but it's... Okay, an Autowerk.
Stupid.
So in Cologne, there's a Henry Ford Street, and Henry Ford also there's a Ford Motor Company in Germany. Yes, they have made business big time with the German Nazis.
I think that's kind of an interesting topic because I know, Michael, I just can't stand these vehicles. They're big, they're bulky, I don't know. There's nothing that great about a Ford, okay? Mm-hmm. But they sell it like, oh, it's affordable and it's the car you should be driving, you know, because they're made in America. Yeah, but they have roots in Germany too. And when you go to when we were in Europe in 1989, we landed in Oslo, Norway, and drove a Ford from a rental company, and it was a Ford that was produced in Europe. Mm-hmm. And I just found it strange, you know. It just, what's with this?
Yeah, he was being awarded with the German Eagle Order. The highest ranking order of the Third Reich for foreigners. Yeah, of course, he was part of the big war machine.
Yeah. Rewarded, yes.
Yeah. Of this is, you see, they wanted to make money big time.
Oh.
As well as Kennedy was involved in the German.
That reminds me, was he involved in promoting this article from Abbe Burrell on...
I know what you mean, but I don't know. I haven't looked it up.
Yeah, the protocols of the learned elders of Zion is what.
Yeah, he was more or less, he was against Jews also. In the interview of 1950, this depicted here at least that he was saying that the banksters are just Jews, and you see, he was if you make business with your mate with the Third Reich, you have to take a stand, and then after you achieve the position that your business partner also has. You see that the assembly lines Ford would like to forget. Yeah, all these forced workers at Ford organization, Polish people, etc. And many people look there to how they can manufacture things more economically. Yeah, so they were doing things very fast at Ford, and therefore they had the Tennessee, I think it was most named. Yeah. So that was it's just about money. It's nothing else. It just, you know, this is a Ford Motor Company in Michigan, and I know that we here in Germany we have an independent car line of Ford for Europe. Yeah, that's it. Yeah. So he was building the things so fast that maybe he was the role model for Charlie Chaplin Modern Times, when Charlie Chaplin was that hilarious scene in Modern Times, if you remember that. Charlie Modern Times. I do love that film, actually, when he was factory scene. Yeah, that's about Ford Motor Company, which I would, I guess, yeah, they were working as crazy to produce all this number of vehicles there. And that's Charlie Chaplin here. Maybe it's a persiflage of Ford Motor Company. I don't know, but it's just Modern Times, and I really like that movie. Always gets me when I look at that video. This is a famous scene. This is it's very artistic. Yeah, Charlie Chaplin himself, a dictator, also. Yeah, this is a very famous scene. That's the modern age, the industrial age. Yeah, now there's been the movie back. Yeah, it's can clearly see that. But it just to point out that it is just about making money big time. And officially, he was against Jews, and so yeah, people were having a bad time when they have to work in that companies. Yeah, you see that.
Well, and speaking of Jesuits, I mean, you know, it's just nothing new. Just it seems like, you know, everything Jesuit gets promoted by default in this world. You know, it just does.
Mm.
And that's obvious that the Jesuits are running it all then. So.
Yeah, I know that Ford did make many lorries for the Nazis and so, but I never looked into that very deeply, because I thought that was not that big deal. Everybody was doing their best to achieve money. Yeah, so you can come up with that frequently. But for me, that was not the big point. You see that Ford is a general car seen over here. It has no status. It has no recommendation. You drive a Ford if you don't want to expose yourself. It's they are decent cars. They are not special, except a few cars. The Escort Cosworth of the 1990s. I had one from a customer. A very great cars. But apart from that, I love the Ford Capri. But that's it, actually. Yeah. So Ford regularly just made cars for the average people, for the average worker people, usually. That's it. That's about it. I cannot tell you something about Ford in particular. I never got into him, if he was a Freemason or something like that. I didn't go into this.
No. No, of course not. But I just thought, you know, now we know that these big money people all work for the same monarchy, don't they?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But that's something we're never taught. That's not something that we're ever allowed to think about on our own in official source, from official institutions, let's put it that way. It's outside of institutional learning. You have to do your own research, Michael.
Mm-hmm. Let's look up how much we have approached 1 hour. Okay, can I quit it now here on the...
Oh, absolutely. Yeah,
you see, Hitler was a great admirer of Ford. Of course, they had to come up with the industrial production in Germany, and Ford was seen as the role model for the German industry. Yeah, so that in a broad sense, he was just handing over the knowledge how to produce fast and efficient. And so therefore, he was... being seen as a partner in business. That's it. If Ford would have approached the Asian market, he would have become a follower of Hinduism. You see that these people are opportunists. I don't care about his personal opinion.
There
You don't
want you go. They're
just
opportunists.
They're
yes.
opportunists. Yeah. Yeah. So I don't think that he was a high ranking this or that. It does not necessarily mean that he was into the belief system. All the people who are that rich, of course, are in the Antichrist spirit. So that's just the average, the broad term. Mm-hmm. Before we go into the NASA and all the things that maybe you would like to know much more about it, you have to go back to basics. And when we go back to basics, we have to think about the things that we have talked about 50 sessions or 60 sessions before. So when we came down to the path that everything in this so-called solar system has been named about Roman gods. Yeah, you see that solar system, even that is difficult to find. So that in that solar system here, for example, the education poster, so you have to believe it, this you will be educated with that. You have the sun, which is dominant here, also from the size, which is not dominant to see from the earth. So from the earth, the size of sun and moon is quite similar. But we have to believe that in the solar system, the sun is so dominant, it's so big, it's so huge, that we on that teeny tiny fragile earth here, we are just very unimportant.
Well, you make a very valid point, Michael, that the sun is actually proportioned almost exactly the size of the moon, because you see that in a... In photos of when you have an eclipse of the sun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sure, otherwise it would not work. And so they have to come up with the claim that the moon is much more far, much more nearer, and the sun is much more further away, so that they have the same proportions. how you will prove that? Yeah, do you know that or do you believe it? You cannot approach it, so you have to believe it. Oh yeah, you can have your triangular things, but you see that you have not a reference point. You cannot look on the outside. Even if Felix Baumgartner is ascending 24 miles up high,
it's not that's very far.
That's not very far.
No, that's not far.
Yeah. So you have to believe your scientists who come up with all the things that is 60 million kilometers, 100 million kilometers. So you are just have to simply divide the numbers by 1.6. Yeah, so the distance between the sun and the earth is about 150 million kilometers, which would mean that it is about 90 million miles. Yeah, and Felix had just achieved 24 of the 90 millions. So what would you like to prove? Yeah, also the other things here, it's all been mentioned and named after Roman gods. Mercury is the messenger of the gods. Venus is the goddess of fertility and sex, love, erotic. Yeah, Mars is the Roman god of war. Jupiter is the head god. Saturn is the end of all things. Means that actually it's Satan. Yeah, and Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto. Pluto is debatable nowadays, and Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto, they came up in the 18th and 19th-20th century, so that these are the new ones, and they were not necessarily needed because the old system just consisted of seven so-called celestial bodies for each day one planet. And we know that the Earth is not a planet, but you see that in the solar system, it's been seen as one. So Sunday, you got the day for your sun. On Monday, the moon is not depicted here, but on Monday, it's the day of the moon. On Tuesday, it's the day of, I have to look it up. It was the day of Mars. Tuesday, always it's Dienstag, Tuesday. My. Oh no, and it's not a band and this and Tuesday God. Usually I know that from memory. Yeah, it's Mars. Okay. Mm-hmm. Where am I? So Bam, bam. So, back again. Sunday is the sun, Monday is the moon, Tuesday is Mars, Wednesday is Mercury. I know that from memory because in French it's Mercredi. Yeah, Mercredi, it's been named the Wednesday. Then you got Thursday, it's the day of Thor, T-H-O-R. It's a Roman or it's a German god of thunder. It's the Greek Zeus, and the equivalent is then the Roman Jupiter. So then Thursday is the day of Jupiter, and Friday is the day of Frida. It's the German equivalent of Venus. And Saturday is in that Antichrist system, not Sabbath, but the day of Saturn. And Saturn means the one with the ring on top. It's the Lord of the Rings, and it's the one with the sickle. It's the skeleton. It's the death. It's been seen as the death planet. There you have the mentioning of seven celestial bodies in the order of the week. No? Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Saturday, not Sabbath, Saturday. And that is what in the old times, in the Babylonian science, where we have talked about that deliberately 50 or 60 sessions before, that is actually the zodiac. Which means that is the circle around the Earth. That's the circle around the Earth. Yeah, and you remember about the 36 rulers.
Or deacons, yeah.
Yeah, of the zodiac. So that means, in other words, that you got in the system here, which was in the old times a geocentric system, you have the planets here on the outside. So I know that it is the ruler of the zodiac. That's the head god, ruling planets of the zodiac. Let's see it from that perspective. So nowadays been depicted that everything is moving around the sun. In the old times, these planets here. Let's look at a horoscope. Horoscope radix, which means the root. It's also Latin. Yeah. You see the circle here with the Earth is not depicted at the center, or Terra, if you would like to have it in Latin. Yeah, and you see that all the so-called planets, and the moon is not a planet, but you see that all these celestial bodies are moving. And here, because you see that the moon is moving very fast, and Pluto and Saturn are moving very, very slowly. So this is a moving, this is a moving tablet here. So that means that the old people in the Babylonian Chaldean science, they saw the planets as gods because they were able to walk. Yeah. So these planets were able to move. Therefore, they were seen as alive. And the fixed stars, for example, the big wagon and Sirius and all the fixed stars, they were immovable. So they were seen as dead, and they were seen as the remains of dead humans, especially of dead kings. So things which were moving, which were visible by the naked eye, they were seen as gods. So they saw the planets as God, which actually is a very, in a nutshell, is they saw the creation as the creator. They venerated the worship, they venerated the planets as gods. Yeah, remember that the snake or the serpent said to Eve, ye shall be as gods. Multitude, not one, but ye shall be as gods. So the gods of the ancient times were the planets. And that kept until the Roman Empire, and even further until our very days, because you see that the planets here, so the moving stars, a planet does mean wandering star, the planet's been seen as gods, until this day been venerated under the name of the Roman equivalent gods, which is just another name of the Greek mythology. which is just another name of the Babylonians. But it's just not different now today. You see that the children in school, they have to learn the Roman system of mythology. When it comes down to the name of the days of the week, and when it comes down to the names of the so-called planet, or when you count down to the moon, to the so-called heavenly bodies of the so-called solar system, you see one error after one error, one after one error after an error. Yeah, so you got a bunch of theories together, and it seems so logical because you see that it makes absolutely sense. The problem is when the foundation is rotten, everything is rotten. And the foundation is rotten because it depicts here a dominant sun against the minor planets, and the Earth is not a planet at all because the Earth is the center. And now you look at this solar system and you don't see the center. If somebody would be in the center, it would be the head god, the Jupiter. Therefore, we have to take another approach from the Chaldeans, from the Mesopotamia, from thousands of years before Christ. Yeah, and so that is that what all the Antichrist system and Antichrist governments, Antichrist agencies, etc. do. They have to rely on the wrong system of the solar system of the Jesuits. And then combine it with the name of Roman gods, of certain numerals, of certain rites, of certain rituals, and mix it up with all pagan religion. So that is actually that what has been sold as science, but is no science at all. But it is what it is. It's gnosis. It's actually science so-called in the Bible. And this is science so-called because you cannot prove it. Do you know it or do you believe it? Okay, you can see the Venus with your own eye, but you cannot tell how much it is away. And you cannot see the Uranus without a very big telescope, for example. So you have to believe that this is Uranus, and you have to believe that it has something to do with this or with that. And even in that name, Uranus, I know that some people come up and say, oh yeah, this is a gay name. Uranus is so old, it's also part of a mythology. That is what many people don't grasp. Yeah, Uranus and Saturn are connected. Yeah, it is not only a name of a planet, but it has several meanings. So you see that here on Wikipedia even, they say, oh, that's Uranus as a planet. But it has nothing to do, and has been discovered by William Herschel in Bath. That's the city where Peter Gabriel is located, B-A-T-H, in Great Britain. There he was. So that Uranus has several meanings. Yeah, Uranus is a planet, and in the Greek mythology, that is also a god. Let's go in English here. You see that Uranus here is the personification of the sky and one of the Greek primordial deities. According to Hesiod, if he ever lived, Uranus was the son and husband of Gaia. The son and husband. Sounds familiar, Brett? Son and husband?
No.
Huh? Think of Babylonian. Think of Nimrod and Tammuz.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Uranus was the son and husband of the Earth, so of Gaia, with whom he fathered the first generation of Titans. Mm-hmm. Uranus is associated with the Roman god Kaelos. And then you only have to search about Saturn. Oh, sorry, that's on Kronos. Ah, him, the same thing here. Oh, it's not been mentioned here. Ah, interesting. So you have to look another approach. Ah, they don't tell you anything nowadays on Wikipedia. So Saturn and Kronos, or Kronos with K. My. It's really hard, and then you have to translate it into English. In Greek mythology, Kronos, was the leader and youngest of the first generation of Titans, the divine descendant of the primordial Gaia and Uranus. So Saturn is the sun, or one of the sun, because Kronos is another name of Saturn. Saturn is now Roman and Kronos is now Greek. Yeah. So you see that when you have to translate it into the Roman mythology, then it is what it is. It is that Saturn is the son of Uranus, who then is depicted with a harp, sickle or sickle, which was the instrument he used to castrate and depose Uranus, his father. The sickle. Yeah. Then going back to the, where is the solar system when you need it? Yeah, there's a solar system. Yeah. So this is all coming down from mythology. Yeah, so this Uranus has been mentioned from the Greek mythology and not from the Roman mythology. But Saturn is the son of Uranus. And Neptune is the same word or the same so-called deity as Poseidon in Greek. So they mix a little bit up, but you see that in the end, it is just what it is. It is just names of deities. And the sun is the god. Yeah, it's the biggest here. Jupiter is the head god of the gods, but the sun is so prominent here because it's all about the sun god. It's all about the sun god. And don't ask what his name actually is, because this name is not the sun. It's not the sun. Yeah, but we will find out very soon, I think. So that is the beginning of the veneration of heavenly things, of divine things, seen from the perspective of the earth. When you look upon the sky with its beautiful stars, who are fixed, who are so-called dead, fixed stars, they don't move, they are fixed. And with the planets, which means the wandering stars, they've also been stars, they've also been venerated, because people want to be venerated as stars. But the stars, the big stars, the head stars, the gods themselves are the people who are moving in the zodiac around the earth. The zodiac is the imaginative band or circle around the earth, 360 degrees. I don't debate now it's this shape of earth or that. It's just that you have to look upon it from the perspective of an ancient tribe, from an ancient inhabitant, and you look to the night sky, and then you see there are planets moving, and the most prominent thing you know on the heavenly bodies is, of course, the moon, which is sometimes full moon or half moon, crescent moon, etc., etc. So that is the perspective here. They've been seen as gods. That's the reason why the Egyptian pyramids have been designed according to the time period they were built before, most probably before the flood, to the fixed stars of Orion, yeah, with the fixed star Sirius. So that is just about that they have venerated the pagan religion. It has nothing to do, the pyramid has nothing to do, don't fool that be yourself be fooled from Kent Hovind nowadays. He was brilliant in the old days, but now don't be fooled when he's telling you that the purpose of the pyramid would be to venerate Jesus Christ because he is the cornerstone. Oh, wow. Yeah, we had talked about that in the sessions too. So that is the approach. The approach is that you, when you go back to the Roman system, you venerate all these pagan religions, because the Roman religion has been mingled together with all these pagan religions. You see that in the monstrance. Yeah, that's the sun symbol here. It's the same symbol, more or less, with the rays of the sun as the symbol of the Jesuits. It's a sun symbol. So their center point of veneration is the sun. When Jesus was breaking bread with his disciples, it is not likely that he was having scissors with him, and then he made circular things or something else. You see that he just broke the bread and it was not circular. That I'm absolutely, or I'm almost sure, I wasn't there, so, but I believe, I cannot know because I wasn't there, I believe that he did not break the bread in a circular shape. Yeah, but this is what you have to believe in the Roman Catholic Church and in other cults too, that is just a veneration of the sun. It's so obvious here. You see that also in very much cathedrals and churches. For example, when I was doing Kennedy, lately, when his coffin was in the church, yeah. Look at this picture, please. Yeah? You see, in that cathedral, his coffin has been enlightened by the sun.
Ah, you know what that cathedral is, Michael? Mm-hmm. It's the Capitol Rotunda. It says right there. You see that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that's our so-called capital of the United States.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it is what it is, and you have that in many official buildings, and also, of course, in many cathedrals. That there is on top of it, there is a glass or something where the sun is shining in a circular way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that is just that just came into my mind because I'm recently in the investigation of Kennedy and the religious background of it. Yeah. That's my point, Brad. You see that they are just venerating the sun with their monstrance and with their sky domes and all the things. They're just venerating the sun. That is the oldest form of worship, and the cross even itself is a sun symbol. If you don't follow my explanation, then you have to read Alexander Hislop, The Two Babylons, for example. That it is depicted that the cross actually is a symbol for the sun. It has something to do with the eye. Yeah, but that's the problem of it. You
oh,
see,
yeah. It goes right back to in hoc signoventus, doesn't it?
Yeah, it goes to the Jesuits. It goes to the Roman Catholic Church. It goes to the ancient cults. You see, it goes to the Celts. It is everywhere because they see the sun as the creator of life.
So everyone knows, in hoc signoventus was the Latin phrase that Constantine came up mm-hmm. with when he had his little vision.
Mm-hmm.
When, you know, in this sign you shall conquer, meaning the cross.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there you go. Perfect.
Yeah, and that's it. That's actually it. You see that it is just a sun symbol. So that means that Jesus Christ was crucified to the sun. Or to the sun god, at least to the pagan god. Don't care what his name is. I know what his name is. And next session you will find out. And the thing is that you have to know the ancient root of the veneration of planets. If you don't know that, you don't have to know that there are 36 deacons from each of the 12 zodiac signs divided by 10 degrees. There are three by 12, then 36 deacons, and if you sum up 1 to 36 in a row, you come up with 666. And that's the ancient sun worship, and that's of course the same when some bishop or pope or who else has a cross symbol on his suit. Yeah, then it's the veneration of the sun. Therefore, it is the number of the beast. The beast is a pagan religion, more or less. Yeah. So if you have the cross in one form or another,
mm-hmm. yeah. The beast is also a tyrannical government too.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You see that here? You got all these crosses here. I pointed out here with the sun, the religion of the sun. It's always the same. If you look upon on Stonehenge in Great Britain, for example, if you look upon the pyramids, it's all sun worship. Nothing more, nothing less. It's just the sun worship, or equinox, or the Inca. Quetzalcoatl was it, I think. My. Yeah, the snake. Yeah. With the pyramid. Pyramid. Come on. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. You see here. Yeah, with the pyramid. And when there's a shadow, then the snake is depicted here. And some pyramids even have a snake. Snake heads, etc., and so this, yeah, you see it here, a dragon. So that is just sun worshiping, and that's nothing more, nothing less. It's the oldest kind of worship of something that they think people who have not the word of God, people who are not in the Christian belief, people who are just in the pagan belief or belief in nature itself, they believe in the sun as the creator because, oh, it is getting warm and the plants are growing. But especially in the first chapter of the Bible, it is clearly depicted that it was not the the sun, but it was just God who created everything. The word of God created everything, and God brought the light, and plants were growing without the sun. So what convinces you?
I think it's in Corinthians, Michael, somewhere in Corinthians. I'm almost positive of it because I have this. But we speak of wisdom, but we speak the wisdom of God. Okay, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 7. Chapter 2, verse 7. Okay. But we speak of the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. So this is closer to it, but there's something else about that, and I haven't found it yet. So maybe another day when my mind is working better, because my mind is not working good today.
Okay, so then it was the end of the introduction that in the ancient times people were venerating the planets as gods, and they were venerating the sky as divine and supreme, of course, because it is on top of them. And therefore came the old thinking that the moving stars, which the planet is a moving star, were the venerated gods who were on their path around the earth. So that is what it's all about, and that is what also is depicted in our modern solar system. And not only that, it is also depicted in the day schedule. And therefore, I just want that Brett is now closing it down to relieve my computer from all the many windows, and I can tell you that in the next session we were going deeper into the story of space travel, and then we come down to the path of NASA. I don't know if I can cover it in the next session, but we have to take a stand here because we have to really realize that it is all about religion. This science is not only a new religion, but science is a very old religion, venerating elements, venerating planets, venerating stars, venerating the sun. That is venerating the creation instead of the creator. And that is an old myth, that is an old method which really worked and really works in the future also, because people who don't want to have a God, don't want to follow anything, they just see the things as they appear, but they don't know the meaning of it. And now we go into the so-called science of the space. Therefore, it is the same as in the old times, the Egyptians and the Babylonians, the Chaldeans, the Sumerians, the Egyptians have looked upon the sky and said,
you know, we can make some more progress. But yeah, science is a real big struggle today, because it's a science that we clearly see now, Michael, thanks to your efforts, that was developed under occultic and alchemical means. And it is very corrupt, very corrupt. And we see that corruption in the pharmaceuticals today, don't we? Very, very corrupt. And they're making all kinds of money on it. So, yeah, it's a very nasty topic that needs to be addressed. And Michael and I are glad to do it. So we hope to catch up with you next time. And thank you for bearing with us in our difficult moments, because we're definitely going to have them, and you can expect, because you look at the nature of the subject, it's just heavy, it's big, it's huge, and we're forced to carry it All of us are. It's like in Matthew 23 all over again. So we encourage you to stay in that spirit with us, and that we will pursue the topic of science as the new religion and prove that it is not necessarily new. Nothing new under the sun, Michael. So we'll catch up with you next time. God bless and Maranatha.